Well, happy spring. Did you remember it's spring is in the air? The spring equinox. That means now the days are going to get longer, at least daylight hours. Days don't change 24 hours, but the daylight hours will be changing. But that also means it's going to be warmer. I'm not looking for that. But that's okay. Marcia and I were able to see Larry and Gina this week, and they said to tell you all hello. They love you very much. They wish they could be back here. But apparently not enough because they're still home spring. And so the warm weather and the hikes. I went down with Marcia and I had to work during the day, so I didn't get to enjoy their hikes, but Larry would come back every day with a backpack full of rocks. And so he was collecting treasures, more treasures for him. And then, of course, a few times a day, they would be going to thrift stores as well. So he's got his truck halfway full in the back of the treasures that he's found. But they wanted me to let you know that they love you very much. And it is unusual to be speaking to a crowd again instead of just staring into your phone and recording something, so that could be different as well. But let's start off. We're going to talk about one of the doxologies. Now, we sing a song called Doxology, and I should have put that in here. I don't know why I didn't, but praise God from whom all blessings flow. You know that song. But there are numerous doxologies in the New Testament, and we're going to be looking at one of them from two verses of the book of Jude. But if I asked you to share with me later, maybe, the most important truth in all the realm of salvation. When you think of salvation, what is the doctrine or the truth that comes to your mind? What's the most important? What's the most amazing, the most profound, the most blessed doctrine that makes up the theme of salvation? Which doctrine is most crucial? Which element of God's saving promise is most encouraging, most satisfying, most comforting? Now, of course, all the elements of salvation are important. They're necessary, they're precious. But one stands out to me. It reminds me of the beauty of why we're joined to Christ. And it's one that Church of Christers rarely mention. I don't know if it's because we're afraid of it, or that it leans too close to Calvinism, which is probably the reason why. It is, however, one of the most comforting elements that I know of salvation. Well, without holding you in suspense any longer, I'll tell you, Calvinists call it, and this is what's scary, they call it the doctrine of eternal security, or otherwise known as the perseverance of the saints. If you look at their tulip logo, the last P, the P is for the perseverance of the saints. And it's scary because you hear the word Calvinism and immediately you're gonna shudder. I'm not gonna go to Calvinism today, okay? So you just relax, take a deep breath. But it sort of tips that way. And it's a biblical principle. And so I wanna share that with you in this doxology that we're gonna be reading about from Jude. Now, while this doctrine of perseverance of the saints is difficult to defend, I think the Bible teaches the potential is there. The potential of being saved, once saved, always saved. You've heard that slogan, and that's scary to some. Once saved, always saved. Oh, you can't think about that. Well, that's because we've had to earn our way to salvation. And instead, if we look at our life and look at our salvation as in Christ and as secure in Christ and as comforting in Christ, we can be saved once and always forevermore. Do you believe that potential? Through Christ, all things are possible. We can be saved from when we initially receive salvation at immersion and be saved the rest of our lives and the rest of eternity. Now, I'm not diminishing the glories of the doctrine of justification or regeneration or conversion or adoption or reconciliation, redemption or ransom, forgiveness. But I and Jude want you to feel secure in your relationship, your stance with Christ. And so today we're bringing this short series from the book of Jude, or the letter of Jude, to its conclusion. It's written by Jesus' half-brother, and he's, of course, the child of Mary and Joseph, Jesus just of Mary and the Spirit. But he brings this message of false teaching and avoiding false teaching, but then closes with this beautiful benediction of praise to God. And so let's read those final two verses. I'm in Jude verses 24 and 25. This is from the New International Version. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ, our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. Now, all those doctrines I mentioned a moment ago would be diminished to some degree if we could not be saved for now and forever, if the potential was not there. Because what would it mean, regeneration and forgiveness and all those other things? It just take a little edge off of that if it wasn't potentially possible for us to live for joy. It would depreciate the all-consuming joy, the confidence, the assurance, the rest, the comfort, the hope. They would all be downgraded and replaced with doubt and fear and anxiety and worry if eternal life was not in our grasp or if we were unsure of its promise. And so, are you feeling in your relationship with Christ? Do you ever feel doubt, fear, anxiety, worry? You may want to rethink your position and your stance next to Christ, because he says he's able to take us, to help us to stand in that presence. Now, Jesus told us for sure we must confess him as Lord. We must deny ourselves, take up our cross daily, be obedient in submission to his will. And the demand is so great that there are some that just say, that's too great of a task for me. He says it's hard to find the truth. It's hard to accept the truth, hard to believe the truth. And he says you must count the cost. But we do this because we know the alternative for unrepentant sinners is eternal death. We want eternal life. And so you're telling me that salvation can be forever? Yes, indeed. I'm in 1 John chapter 5, verse 6, down through verse 15. This is the one who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. He did not come by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. For there are three that testify, the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And the three are in agreement. We accept human testimony, but God's testimony is greater, because it's the testimony of God, which he has given about his Son. Whoever believes in the Son of God accepts this testimony. Whoever does not believe God has made them out to be a liar, because they have not believed the testimony God has given about his Son. And this is the testimony. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, We know we have what we ask of him. And so John writes those things so that we may know we have eternal life, and we may be secure in that stand, in that stance with him. Now, a doxology or a benediction, this is another way to term it, answers the question. Let's go back and read it again. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. And so, you know, whenever we come to a doxology like this, we're almost tempted not to talk about it in a sermon. Rather, we could just summarize it. He is able. We're going to sing that song in a minute or two. But the idea of that he is able, he's able to keep us from stumbling. He's able to keep you so that one day you will be able to stand in his presence, in his glory, in his, and be blameless with great joy. It's beautiful. Now, a doxology, if you look at the word, the Greek is doxa and logos. So it's a word, logos, of praise. That's what a doxology is. So it's a word of praise, or several words of praise. Scripture is filled with them. If you, we just read recently the Psalms, went through the Psalms. Do you know that the Psalms are divided up into five books? And each of those books, at the end of those books, has a doxology of praise. Chapter 41, verse 13, chapter 72, verses 18 and 19, chapter 89, and I'm using chapters. Greg would be mad at me for calling them chapters, but that's okay. Verse 52, because that's the way I'm going to divide it. But chapter 106, or Psalm 106, verse 48, and then the entire 150th Psalm, the last Psalm, is a three verses, I think, or four verses. It's an entire doxology that closes the book. And so that songbook of the saints, of the redeemed, it's punctuated or climaxed in responses of praise for God's glorious work among his people. So I'd encourage you to go back and look at those doxologies there. Well, here in Jude, he gives praise to the only God, the only Savior, who through Jesus Christ our Lord is to receive all honor and glory and majesty, all dominion, all authority forever, because he is able to keep us and he's able to help us stand before his presence. Now, of course, the angels sang a doxology at Jesus' birth in Luke chapter 2, verse 14. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to those to whom his favor rests. People gave a doxology at Christ's arrival in Jerusalem. Remember when he rode on the colt of a donkey? And they all shouted, they all cheered, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. That's Luke 19, verse 38. The New Testament is filled with various doxologies. Here's a couple more. I'm not going to read them, but if you want to write these down. Romans 16, 25 through 27. Galatians 1, 3 through 5. 1 Timothy 1, 17. No doxology deals with the mundane. Always deals with salvation. It always deals with glorification. Things that are eternally marvelous. They are words of grateful praise to God for saving sinners. And a doxology is just that. It's a foretaste of heaven. It's a word of praise for what we're going to experience for eternity. And that's what we're going to do forever, ever. Declare doxologies to God. Outbursts of praise, contemplating the greatness of salvation and of overcoming false teaching is what Jude is focusing on. Now, a doxology calms our fears, it fuels our hopes, it gives us joy and helps us visualize the heavenly, but above all, a doxology pours out praise to the one who is able, the one who deserves ultimate gobs and heaps of praise. That's New King James. Before we look at this particular doxology in a little more detail, let me just recap the letter. We know that it was written to false teachers who snuck in, who crept in among the church. If Jude was writing to us, which one is it? Who is it? Doug's already confessed that it's him. But so they have these false teachers that crept in unnoticed, verse 4 says. They're like reefs underneath the surface. You can't see them, but they're there, and they're going to scrape the bottom of the boat. They're going to sink it. He says down in verse 12 that they are hidden in the church. They deny the lordship of Christ. They're embedded in the church. And Jude goes on to give history of these kinds of apostates. He characterizes them for us as well, and what they've done and who they're like, so that we can compare them. Then after the long description, if you read all the way down to verse 17, he says, but, dear friends. So he's explained all these false teachers, what they're doing and who they're like. However, he says, how are you going to defend yourself with false teaching? How are you going to protect yourself? How are you going to fight the truth? And here's what he tells us in a summary form. He says, remember the words of the apostles. They foretold what was coming, that scoffers would come and the ungodly would come. Don't be surprised, he says. It's prophesied. We know it's coming. We know there's going to be, in the last day, false teachers. He says, build yourselves up in the most holy faith by praying in the Spirit, spiritual prayer, spiritual songs that we've sung today. Keep yourself in God's love as you wait for the merciful eternal life, he says. Show mercy to those who doubt and who are afraid. Save others by snatching them from the fire, but don't get burned yourself. Hate corrupting influence and practices that pollute the flesh. And those are things we've talked about in recent weeks. So we're to reach out to people in danger, reach out to them and snatch them from the fire. Those who are being captivated and who are listening to the beautiful sounds of these false teachers, who it sounds good, it sounds right, let me follow that. But remember the leaven of the Pharisees. False teaching has a powerful influence in it. Can suck you into it. And they were able to persuade. You think about this. The Pharisees and the religious leaders on the day of Jesus' crucifixion, they were able to persuade regular Israelites to start joining in, crucify him. And they worked the crowd up to a frenzy, so the crowd joined in that, who probably the day before would not have said those things, who would not have chanted or shouted, crucify him. But yet the leaven of the Pharisees persuaded them, infiltrated their hearts, and got them. And so what if we get too close to a false teacher? That's kind of a scary thought. What if I get too much, you know, if it is Doug, and we listen to him, some of his things sound good, some we're not too sure about, but what if we get too close? Could I fall? Could I fail? Could I reject the truth? Could I be so polluted and stained by false teachers that I'm going to abandon the faith? Some do. Will I remain in God's love? Those are tough questions. Those are critical questions. But thankfully, this short letter ends with a statement of assurance. Even though, beware of false teachers. Take note of them. But they're false teachers. Identify that false teaching. And don't cling to it. Instead, cling to what is right. And so we know, Jude says, there are two things to know. First, he is able to keep you from stumbling. Do you believe that? If we talk to a false teacher, have you ever talked to a false teacher? I have. I used to be a false teacher. So I'm hopefully not today, but right? I've taught things that are wrong. And he'll keep us from stumbling. Secondly, he is able to present us before God without fault and with great joy. And that's really all I want to know. Can he keep me? Can he get me there in the presence of glory? And Jude says not only that he can do it, but he will do it. Preserve us and present us. So let's look at those two things in just a little more detail. First, he says he is able to keep us from stumbling. Keep us from stumbling. Remember, the Lord is able to do it. I'm so glad he's able. I'm so glad he has the power to do that. He has power to exert people, to raise them from the dead, to resurrect them. He has the power to keep me from stumbling. God is able. He's holy. He hates sin. He never wants evil for his children. He always wants us to succeed and to be to do what's right so that he is glorified and so that we do what's best for us as well. He wants us to be holy. And so the obvious answer to the question, does he want us to be kept to the end? Absolutely. Yes, he is able. He is able. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9 reminds us, it says, the Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. You see, believers at the time of Peter's writing were wondering when the Lord would take them home, when he's coming back. He promised us, you know, a couple decades ago, he's coming back, he's going to come. When's it going to be? Well, we look a couple millennial back. And we might wonder, when's he coming? When's it going to be? When's he going to take us home? But interestingly, God doesn't watch the clock. I don't know if you're basketball fans, but this is my heaven on earth. The NCAA tournament, the college basketball tournament. 64 teams start out. One's going to end up a national champion. And you watch the clock. You look at the clock and you think, oh, there's 24 seconds, we're down by three. How are we gonna do this? What strategies is the coach gonna use to do this? And we start watching the clock, we start watching, well, who do we play next? And we begin thinking about the calendar and what's happening next. Well, God doesn't watch the clock. He doesn't watch the calendar. When the time is perfect, just like when the strategic moment in time was perfect to send Jesus the first time to be crucified, there's going to be a strategic point in time, and we're going to look back on that and think that was the perfect time right there. That was the time that he sends Jesus on the second occasion to take us home. But we might wonder, we might speculate, when's that going to be? God is not slack. He's not a slacker. He's lovingly patient. It's not because he won't fulfill his promises, because he's being patient toward his people, toward you. Not wishing that any of us would perish, but that all would come to repentance. In John chapter 6, we have another important passage. It says, all those the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. That's John 6, verse 37. The Father gives the bride to his son. And Ephesians 5 talks about that, verses 25 through 27. How that the bride is waiting for the husband, and he gives us to the son. So the question is not about God's willingness. It's not about God's purpose, because we know he's willing. We know he has purpose to save us. The question is he able? And that's what 1 Timothy 2 verse 4 says. He wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. He desires us to become, to come into eternal life. And so is he able? Yes. Now he who is able, that's what Jude says. He is the only God, our Savior. And if he doesn't save us, we aren't going to save ourselves. There's no possible way for us to save ourselves. And so if he didn't save it, who's going to, right? And so we trust him for that salvation. He is able. That's the Greek word dunamino, or where we get the word dynamite from. It has the power. He has the power to save, the power to explode our old life and create a brand new one. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego believed that he had the power to save as they stood in that furnace of fire. Do you? Do you believe he has the power to save you now and forevermore? Well, secondly, he is able to present us before God without fault and with great joy. This is incredible. Now, to him who is able to keep you from falling and to make you stand in the presence of his glory, blameless with great joy. In the Greek, it means to set you or to stand you or to present you. Right? Whenever you had your child, if you have had children, right? The first child. My parents got mad at me because When Kyle was born, we were in a birthing room and then in the across the hall into a place where they actually cleaned him up and weighed him and all that kind of stuff. Well, they let me carry him from that room across there, and all my family was standing in the hallway there. And I just kind of went like this, and that kept going. And I didn't stop and actually show him to them. Later I did, right? But that's the idea. You present him, you say, look, here's my son. Or here's my daughter. Here's my granddaughter, right? And you present them as a beautiful thing, as a wonderful thing. Well, that's what, through Jesus, is going to happen to us. He's going to present us to the Father in all of his glory and honor and say, this is my brother, this is my sister. Look at him, perfect, faultless, in glory themselves. Right now we stand in God's grace, Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 4. Soon we'll stand in his glory. And this is the opposite of falling. This is standing. It's enduring to the end. It's perseverance to the end. Perseverance of a saint. Right? Weird, I know. True believers have been given a faith that endures, and he who keeps us will set us in the presence of God. If you're interested in homework, and by the way, this is like really difficult homework. So it's a struggling passage. So here it is. 1 John 2, verses 19 through 27. So 1 John 2, 19 through 27. If you want difficult homework, check it out. Let's talk about it and see what you discovered and how it ties in with standing secure in God's presence. I'm just going to leave it at that and let you enjoy that. Whenever anyone reads in the Bible about somebody who was in the presence of God, you would think it'd be great. But actually, the people that we read about that are standing in God's presence are in trauma. They're experiencing a horrific trauma. Isaiah pronounces a curse on himself. Woe is me, right? Ezekiel falls over like a dead person. Peter, James, and John on the Mount of Transfiguration, almost in a semi-coma, except with Peter's blabbering mouth. Hey, we got to build three houses for each of you guys, right? Peter, that's it. Just focus here. Focus for a minute. ADHD Peter written all over. John in the book of Revelation sees the vision of Christ and is like a dead person. Just absolutely scared out of their wits till they faint. Whenever anybody is in the presence of God in Scripture, maybe that's where we're frightened sometimes about it. And we think it's going to be a frightening experience because we know we're sinners. And we're going to stand before God and we're still wondering in the back of our mind, am I saved? Am I lost? Wondering. John wrote to us and says, so that you know you have eternal salvation. And so anybody standing in God's presence was traumatized, terrified. That's a place where no sinner can stand. The book of Revelation makes it clear nothing impure will ever enter it, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. That's chapter 21, verse 27. In chapter 22, verses 15 and 16, it says that those inside are washed. Those outside are like dogs or sorcerers or the immoral, the murderers, idolaters, everyone who loves and practices falsehood. Those kind of people don't come into the presence of God. But God, through Jesus, he's going to stand us in God's presence. And our knees aren't going to be shaken. We're not going to be wavering. We're not going to fall down as dead. But we're going to stand there in his glory. We're there. Jesus has placed us there. He presents us there. This is one of ours. This is my brother. This is my sister. And so we stand in his glory, in his glorious presence. And Momos, without blame, pure, faultless. This word originally was used to apply to sacrifices, according to Hebrews 9, verse 14. Talks about holy, blameless sacrifices. By ourselves, of course, we are not blameless. We're treated as if we are blameless, though, because Christ bore our sins, and we've been given his righteousness. Think about this. On the cross, God treated Christ as if he lived our life, so that he can now treat us as if we lived the life of Jesus. That's amazing. That's amazing. We're in our present state not worthy to enter heaven, of course, because of our sinfulness. But that's why Jesus transforms us. We lose this body of flesh, go into God's presence, and receive a new body. It's going to happen. He's going to stand us there. He's going to stand us there. We're going to be faultless. Not only will we be capable of doing right, but we're going to have every power, every passion, apart from evil, and only devoted to his holiness. We're going to be there with our heads lifted up, blameless before God. Can you picture that? Will you try and picture that this week? Will you try and imagine yourself blameless before God and thinking about entering his glorious presence? Instead of fear and trauma and panic and fainting, we're going to be overwhelmed with joy. Joy forever. Joy for us, joy for the Father. Zephaniah 3:17 says this beautiful saying, "The Lord will, your God is with you, the mighty warrior who saves. He will take great delight in you. In his love, he will no longer rebuke you, but will rejoice over you with singing." Can you imagine God singing to you? I wonder if he's got a bass voice or a tenor voice. I wonder if he knows four-part harmony. What's it going to sound like when the Lord sings to you as you stand in his presence? A singing welcome into eternity. That's awesome. Not only are we singing praises to God, but he's going to be singing praise concerning us. And Jesus went to the cross for the joy that was set before him. And what's that joy going to be? Fellowship with us forever and ever. He's going to rejoice over us. God's going to rejoice over us. He's going to rejoice over Jesus. And we're going to rejoice over the Father. There was a preacher back in the 1800s. I think he may have been Baptist, so hopefully that won't offend you. But Charles Spurgeon, he says, "I think the most wonderful text in the whole Bible was that Zephaniah verse. God himself singing. He says, I can imagine when the world was made, the morning stars sang together, shouting for joy. But God didn't sing. You go back and read Genesis. God never sings once. He said it was very good and stopped there. There was no song. There was no harmony. But when all the chosen race, when all of us come together and we meet around the throne, the joy of the eternal Father is going to be so swelling with happiness that he's going to burst into song on our behalf. You might want to read Romans chapter 8, verses 33-39. Beautiful passage there. Well, I want you to rest in him, dear Christian. I want you to join the celebration of Jude 25, verse 25. To the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ, our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. Past, present, future. Before ages, now and forevermore. Let it be so. And so all credit goes to the only God. There's only one. And the only God who is our Savior. The only God who is our Savior through Jesus Christ. The only God who is our Savior through Jesus Christ, who is our Lord. To him be all glory, majesty, dominion, and authority. And we are there because he keeps us. He preserves us. He presents us saved by his power divine. Saved to new heights sublime. Life now is sweet, and my joy is complete, for I'm saved, saved, saved. Once we're saved, we can always be saved. And so let's ignore the false teachers and cling to the Master. Let him transform us and push us to new heights, sublime. What a beautiful way to end this letter, what at times was kind of like, oh, that's not very fun. But the ending is, wait for the ending. It's great. So if you're not comfortable in your skin, in your present condition, if you're nervous about your relationship with God, if you're wondering, if you're fearful, if you're concerned, if you're anxious, am I saved? You need to rethink the process. You need to rethink your stance with God, because Jude promises, tells us, he is able to keep us from stumbling. He's able to present us in front of God in his glory, unashamed and totally blessed. Think about your life, and if you need to become a Christian, do so today. It's a great opportunity. Believe that Jesus is the Son of God. Turn from your own way of doing things and pledge your allegiance. Confess his name before men, and then be immersed in baptism. A wonderful, wonderful place to start your relationship experience. If you're struggling, though, and you need to make a change, now's a great time to be willing to change your life and commit yourself to that transforming process. Let's stand. We'll think about it as we sing.